I too would be interested in having a chat with the gentleman who posed this, question. I also have my doubts about the bonnets being actually doing democracy. Barnet Council have a majority of one, and they behave as though they've got an absolute, really great majority. This is from working with the Barnet Alliance for Public Services, where we campaigned against Barnet being privatised, and also campaigning against the libraries being, services being decimated in Barnet, which is also a case, I think, to children under 16. It's a case of, well, we might not be in the EU too long, but it's a case of European Court of Human Rights, but that might fall flat after Brexit. And basically, I think there's a lot in this council that we should be looking at, and I'd be very pleased to have a chat with the gentleman afterwards. Okay, thank you.
Question number 8, please. Rachel, I'd like to stand up. Microphone will find you.
Thank you. I'm Rachel Douglas. And I'm going to go right from the very particular and very local to the absolutely global. Climate change is a major issue facing our globe in the 21st century, and it will adversely affect every single person living in this planet unless we act now. Can you say what each of you would propose to do about it?
Climate change, well, we believe we've got a policy, but basically there's so many things linked to climate change, what is causing climate change. We could start off with the railways, having more transport, which is about a third of all greenhouse gases. We've got the most expensive train fares in Europe. Privatisation hasn't worked out. East Coast Line was not kept in public hands for ideological reasons. I live in Galley Lane, which is basically Galley Backbone because it's between the A1M and Wood Street. There are lots of traffic jams along there, and I often ask myself, do these people really want to be stuck in traffic jams there? Wouldn't they prefer being on trains with their laptops and reading a nice book going to work? That's one aspect. The Green Party, what we're proposing there, other things like food security, waste. It's a whole range of how to combat climate change, which is a bit too long for the 2 minutes I've got there. What we are proposing is air pollution. If we get air pollution under control, that will be about 0.5 degrees or 1.5 degree increase. It's been calculated, I think. If the Green Party has an air pollution law, which is going to be really got teeth in it, and we do something about this, which we can also do already, actually, because Friends of the Earth are going to be campaigning on this, or you can join any other groups to campaign about this, because this is really something that affects us. And with the NHS funding. We're proposing some laws, and there are also things we can do already as private people. That's enough of that. Okay, it's 8:45.
So 2 years ago you were promised the greenest government ever. I don't think fracking in our national parks quite lives up to that promise. Obviously the Labour Party has promised to take our energy suppliers back into public hands, which would mean that we'd be able to direct resources towards developing renewable fuels. Privatisation has not succeeded on this. And we are going to only going to come to state being able to direct money towards it. We've also promised a Clean Air Act to deal with the illegally high air quality in the capital and across our country, which was hidden from us by Boris Johnson when he was Mayor of London. We want to introduce blue belts around the country. We want to look at reducing food waste and packaging waste. I'm not going to, because I know we're running out of time, list everything in our manifesto, but there is a comprehensive list of things that we want to do to make our government the greenest government ever and fulfil on a promise that's been broken to you.
It's vital that we comply with our obligations under the Paris Accord. It's vital that we comply with our obligations under the Climate Change Act. We need to continue to decarbonise the energy generation mix. We're actually now generating around a quarter of our energy from renewables. That's the strongest government, that's the strongest record of any government. And actually, there is a statistic for the 2010 to 2015 Parliament, which we were successful in cutting emissions by 17%. That's the greatest form.
Government has just been sued again over diesel air pollution.
We've had a major uplift in solar capacity, but I think one of the next steps we need to do is a big shift to electric vehicles. I think there is probably a lot of common ground across this panel that not only do we have to address climate change for the sake of future generations, but we also have to tackle the serious problem we have with air quality in this city. And on that basis, it is crucial that we clean up the car network, and that is why the government has provided significant subsidies for electric vehicles. I believe they're going to continue, and I think we need to do more to provide incentives and support to people to scrap the dirtier diesel vehicles. And also, we'll continue to hold to account Volkswagen and the car companies who cheated on the emission test in a disgraceful way. Thank you.
No, there is no common ground. There is no common ground whatsoever. I am furious about the way in which the Conservative government has rolled back all the green measures put in place by the Liberal Democrats and by Sir Edward Davey, who is running for Parliament in Kingston and Surbiton. Support him if you believe you want to. And you in the Green Party, support Edward Davey in Kingston and Surbiton. There is no common ground. The Liberal Democrats put in place good tax measures for green companies developing green technology, innovation and green. These tax measures were all reversed, creating recruitment problems and all sorts of things that I will not go into here. But the point is that the Conservative government reversed the green measures which were put in place by the Liberal Democrats. Let me tell you what we will do. On air pollution, there are 40,000 deaths, additional deaths per year because of poor air quality in the UK, which the Labour mayor has not yet addressed, which the Conservative mayor has not yet attempt to address, and perhaps was annoyed that Europe kept pointing out that London consistently had the worst air quality in Europe. And I understand from colleagues here that Highbarn is not alone in suffering poor air quality. We have a big problem. So what would we do? We would phase out diesel for cars and for small vans by 2025. We would introduce in 10 cities ultra-low emission zones. On the matter of buses and private hire vehicles, we would make sure that all of these were ultra-low or zero emissions. That's on air pollution. Climate change, Rachel Douglas has said, is something about to happen. Actually, in many constituencies, it has already happened with flooding. I visited York recently. They have flood problems. The Liberal Democrats would put in place £2 billion as a flood prevention fund. And yes, our manifesto is the one which is fully costed. We have no uncosted measures in it. Farming. We will focus farming. It is particularly important to ensure that it is green and continues to focus on keeping our country healthy. We would ban fracking by 2030.
What?
And on sustainable electricity, it is simply wrong to say that we are behind. Actually, we were ahead with Liberal Democrat measures. I noticed that a colleague said that we were behind. We were never behind. We have been ahead for some time now. Our commitment is that we would double the production of sustainable electricity to 60% of the total by 2030. We did the work in government. It is steadily being rolled backwards by the Conservatives. They are undoing the good work that we did between 2010 and 2015. Make sure that Sir Edward Davey gets back into the House of Commons, and you will see them being held to account. But vote for me, and I will do that job for you.
Ban fracking now. Let the 20.
Move on to education, to question number 11 from Catherine.
Ban fracking 2030, stupid.
Hi. My son's secondary school has written to all parents to say that their funding is falling by 45% per pupil and that they no longer have the resources to provide a good level of education. How can the UK expect to have a strong economy if we don't invest in the next generation?
Yay.
They want to ban fracking 2030 by then.
The answer is we can't expect a strong economy if we're not investing. A very good website, schoolscuts.org.uk, will show you what the Conservative, Labour and Liberal Democrat manifesto promises on education mean for your local school. For my local school, it means, in the Conservative manifesto, losing the equivalent of 7 primary school teacher salaries over the next 5 years. It's a 1-form entry school. That's the entire staff budget being lost. Now, of course, they're not going to cut teachers over the next 5 years, so that's repairs. That's getting rid of supplies in school. That means empty libraries, extracurricular activities being cut, because that is the reality of what is happening. I said at the beginning, I'm the daughter of 2 teachers. I know how hard teachers work. And I have friends who are teachers, and they are driven to the bone with the cuts right now. They're leaving the profession, my age. They have committed a life to teaching, but it is just too much now. And they need investment. And that is what we would do, because a good education system is the only way to make sure we have a long-term economic plan, which is what the Conservatives keep telling us they're planning on. So we would invest £6.3 billion in schools. We will reduce class sizes to less than 30 for 5, 6 and 7-year-olds. We will introduce free school meals for all primary school children. We will end the public sector pay freeze, so our teachers are properly remunerated for the hard work they do day in, day out, educating our children. We want to consult upon sabbaticals and industry placements for teachers so that they can be better teachers. And we want to reintroduce school staff negotiating body and national pay settlements for teachers, because it is the teachers who are the backbone of our schools. And if we're losing teachers, then that strong economy and all the investment in the world goes nowhere if the teachers in our classrooms are overworked, underpaid, stressed beyond belief and unable to commit the proper attention that every child needs. And that's why only a Labour government will provide the investment in schools that it needs.
And I want to provide you with reassurance. The figures on the school cuts website are not correct.
No.
No school is going to have its funding cut by 55%.
Government figures.
No school is going to suffer a cash
government
reduction
figures.
In its
government
cost.
Figures.
I mean, in its, no school is going to suffer a cash reduction in its budget. These are figures on the school cuts website are just not true. So I can reassure you on that. A Conservative government would increase funding for schools by $4 billion in real terms.
Not enough.
It has
not
also guaranteed in the manifesto that the changes to the way funding is allocated across the country will not result in any school losing out from it, will not result in a cash loss by any school from its budget. Now, those figures are an improvement on the position in the spending review, and I welcome them. I raised this issue with the Education Secretary and with the Prime Minister, having spoken to Barnet Schools about it, and we have listened, and we have committed additional funding to education, but there are limits to what is affordable, and yet again, we have heard from the Labour candidate today, spending promises, running into the billions, removing the pay freeze. We simply have to live within our means as a country. Because if we do not, we end up with an economic crisis. And in the end, the people who suffer most in an economic crisis are those on low incomes and those who depend on the public services that we value. The only way we can fund our schools properly is by sound public finances and a strong economy.
Make the poor pay.
Yeah, definitely.
Question, it's a really important one, perhaps the most important one, because our children are the future of our country, and we all believe in putting our children first, do we not? But it seems like there's some difference of opinion as to what putting them first means. So I'm proposing not only to reverse cuts, but also to invest more. Here's the way in which we would invest more. What you do early in life pays dividends for the rest of the life, and what you do in the early years gives you benefit throughout your life. So we would invest, we would triple the early years pupil premium, which gives children the best start in life, the children from the most disadvantaged families. We would triple this to £1,000 per child. Quality counts. And we would make sure that every early years setting had an early years teacher with a qualification. This would make that more of the children from all backgrounds reached those excellent selective schools, some of which people are speaking about in this room today. We will make sure that children are ready to learn. So we would make the promotion of well-being a statutory duty of the school, and we would ensure that the mental health needs of children are promptly identified and dealt with in school, because that prevents children from not addressing their learning needs because they have other concerns. Free school meals. Our policy is that free school meals should be there for all primary age children, not rolled back, but rolled out to children up to the age of 11. That's our policy. We believe in promoting breakfast clubs. But what is this? Take away the lunch and give them a cold breakfast instead? No. My child is here in the audience tonight. That's not good enough for him, and it's not good enough for your children at school either. Thank you. Manifesto, but why did some people in this room vote for cuts in the first place? School should lose. We must protect the pupil premium and make sure it is protected. Send me to the House of Commons. What is this pupil premium? I see some of you not quite sure. It protects the education of the most disadvantaged children in our community. I do not believe in extending grammar schools. I believe in doing what is seen to work in Finland. We have a member of the audience from Finland, kindly wave. Which is one of the best education systems in the world. You focus on those who are furthest behind, and the standard of everyone else goes up. And I also believe that training for teachers is important. I believe that we should work towards having fully qualified teachers in all our schools. One of my team who is here nodding this evening is qualifying himself as a teacher. He believes in the Liberal Democrats. I believe in the Liberal Democrats in education. This is the reason why I joined the Liberal Democrats and why I decided to do so 20 years ago, because they were putting in place at that time school classroom targets, numbers of people in classrooms, that were far more ambitious than the unambitious Labour targets are now. I'm sorry, Labour is not ambitious enough. I think globally and act locally. You're trying to compete with South Korea. Get real, do more.
Right. Apparently, between 2015 and 2017, 2.0 billion in funding for education was cut, and they expect another 3 billion by 2020, which is continual sinking. And the Green Party, if we were elected, would invest £7 billion in education. We would abolish SATs, which is cause of misery. I mean, SATs after 7-7. Education should be a learning, an experience that enriches. Education should be an experience that enriches and develops you and makes you curious about the world, not having to jump through hoops. And the other thing is, how would we actually fund this? What we ignore constantly is that the mantra of what we hear is the mantra of austerity, and what we ignore constantly is that at least £30 billion a year are not recuperated by the tax office. It could be even more, that's an HMRC figure. We should have shut down the tax havens, and we should have a complete reform of the tax system in order to finance such things. For example, the Tobin tax, which was thrown down by this government, would have been enforced by the EU. But this government turned it down. Most European countries wanted it. We've had a lot more money in our coffers then. We might not even be discussing this. What was called, the garden tax, but it's the land valuation tax, which was actually the idea of Winston Churchill once upon a time. And the idea of taxing all the land in the country, which is not taxed currently, one caveat, how would you do this? Because it's never been taxed before. What would be a just figure to do this? There are lots of ways of recuperating more money. The idea of not being able to fund this is complete and utter lie, actually. As long as that's me, there's no bang on the microphone, actually.
Question number 12. Is Karen here?
Number 12?
Yes, Karen is here. This is a question on housing.
Ooh, nice.
What is the definition of affordable housing?
£100 million.
Yay!
The definition of affordable housing is housing which people can afford and to have a reasonable lifestyle as in addition to that, one which we would expect them to have in our country. Unfortunately, the definitions of affordable housing that are often used are not at all in accordance with that. And that is an issue which is of great concern to many people in my party. Therefore, that is a question that you must keep answering and that we must keep answering as well. I know that one of the reasons why housing isn't affordable is the shortage of it. Called the law of supply and demand. My dad was a teacher as well, a teacher of economics. And although I've not studied economics, I've heard it constantly at home, which is why you'll hear more on the subject. And one of the things that we need is to make up for the fact that that Labour and the Conservatives, particularly in London, took a holiday from building. And the Liberal Democrats, as I've said, I get a sense of deja vu, because the last time I was here speaking with you in 2015, I told you about our plan for 7 new towns outside of London, but within easy reach. And I saw the glee in your eyes, because you wanted those 7 well-designed, modern, new towns outside London within easy reach. I'm still going for that. That's still one of our policies. We want to build 300,000 new dwellings per annum so that we reach that target of 300,000 per annum each year by 2022, 50,000 of which must be both affordable and energy efficient. In government, we ensured that standards on energy efficiency rose anyway. That was a Liberal Democrat priority. The gentleman I mentioned earlier, Sir Edward Davy, took that through. So therefore, the definitions of what is affordable should depend on the age of the person. But that's not a part of policy that I'm talking about. I believe that personally that the definition of what is affordable should be led by common sense as to what is reasonable in terms of spending on housing and what is reasonable to allow people to lead the kind of life that we want everyone to be able to lead in the United Kingdom today in this century. Thank you.
Right, affordable housing, according to our policies, is that the house prices should be no more than 3 times the median income, and at present it's 8 times the median income, and the rent should be about a third of what they are, I think. And also we've got a huge housing shortage in this country, lots of properties are empty. Another aspect of affordable housing is the ecological sustainability of the house, the environmental sustainability, so it's well insulated. We've got the worst insulated houses in Europe, which is amazing, and that could be another source of increasing income around the country. We do have a policy of National Climate Service, which is quite old now, which would be a good idea to get all the houses around the country at a reasonable ecological level. This would also create wealth in other parts of the country where it's not. There's plenty of property land on brownfield sites that could be used as opposed to the onshore sites. Okay. Thank you.
Well, I agree with the implication of the questioner that what counts as affordable in legal terms often doesn't feel very affordable in practical terms. And I also agree that while successive governments haven't built enough homes in this country, we need to do better. We are committed not only to delivering new homes, not only to delivering new affordable homes, but also to delivering a new generation of council houses. And I very much welcome the fact that actually more council houses have been built since 2010 than in the entirety of Labour's 13 years in office. This is something that we need to do. We need this new generation of council houses to give people genuinely affordable homes. We do need to build more homes at all levels. I would emphasise it's perfectly possible to do that without encroaching on the green belt, without encroaching on our green spaces. Those are valuable parts of our local environment, and I will always defend them. but a Conservative government, if it is re-elected, is committed to building more homes, expanding the supply of housing, to enable young people to get on the housing ladder, and also to rent at reasonable rates. Thank you.
So the question asked how do you define affordable housing? If you ask Boris Johnson, it's 80% of market rate. If you ask the Labour Party, it's 30% of market rate. We've committed to building 1 million new homes in the next Parliament, but I believe those should be the right homes at the right price in the right place. They shouldn't be rabbit hutch studio flats. They should not be like that. Rabbit hutches that are going up in Barnet House are not the types of homes. And I agree that we shouldn't be encroaching on our greenbelt land. It's about quality of life as well as the quantity of homes that we build. And that's why we are committed to building, as I say, the right homes in the right place at the right price, so that people of my generation aren't known forever as generation rent and actually have the opportunity that their parents had to own their own home.
Now a final question, number 14, from Ian.
It's the primary responsibility of any government is the protection of its people. How would your party ensure the security of the UK in the face of a growing terrorist threat?
The question was, the first priority of government is the security and protection of the nation. How would your party ensure the security of the UK in the face of terrorism?
Stop selling to Saudi Arabia.
For a start, you have to look at the causes of terrorism. What we're probably thinking about is the Manchester bombing attack last week, and the fact is that this country actually is supporting one country which is exporting a very conservative form of Islam. There are actually three other law schools in Islam which are a lot more liberal, but the Wahhabis happen to be the most strict and more conservative. And this is producing a lot of grief around the world. And we have to be strong in the cause of terrorism. The other factor is, of course, as I said before, we need to be more flexible. We need a defence force that needs to be more flexible. And this will be coming again to the fact that we need better conventional forces, and actually Trident is actually not a means of security. It's a waste of money, very inflexible, and all it does is just you're either going to use it and get a lot more enemies in the world, or you just can't do anything with it. And of course we need to look on why there's why our people are actually drawn into such things such as ISIS and how they're in combat that.
As Northern Ireland Secretary, I saw at firsthand the phenomenal work which is done by our police and intelligence services every day of the year. And they are routinely preventing plots from materialising into attacks on our people. And so to protect this nation from terrorism, the first thing we have to do is support our intelligence services and our police. And that's one of the reasons why we have protected police funding for the spending review. And it's one of the reasons
why we've cut 20,000 police officers.
to recruiting 1,900 more intelligence officers. And that's why we took legislation through Parliament to update the powers that our intelligence services need, which are vital to ensuring that in the internet age, they can do their very best to ensure they are doing all they can to protect us from terrorism. And I'm sorry, but I don't believe Jeremy Corbyn, a man who has voted against every piece of legislation.
Theresa May, David Davis voted against it as well. Good God.
There is a role for anti-terrorist legislation. There is also a need to decrease the sense of alienation. And this is important to recognise that with a tricky problem, a difficult one, which is threatening the livelihoods and our way of life, that you combat on all fronts. You don't just use surveillance, you don't just use security forces. Indeed, it's an unfair burden to put in our hyper-competent security forces. It is important that we ensure, for example, Lib Dem policy, that we suspend arms sales to Saudi Arabia and control arms exports to countries with terrorism in Iraq. It is important that we continue to spend 0.7% of our national income on aid, that we reduce poverty, that we defend human rights. I also have an issue with PREVENT. I sat in a PREVENT training session. I went to an Afghan community centre and I sat in a PREVENT training session. At the time, I was a candidate for the whole of London and I was invited to sit in. I was shocked to learn that at other such sessions, people had been reported to the security services. And so everybody there sat quiet as mice, taking in the training, but not really engaging and not really participating. This is what I mean by creating a sense of alienation. The Conservative Party has created that sense of alienation amongst minority ethnic communities. I'm the vice chair of Ethnic Minority Liberal Democrats, so I hear about this day in, day out. We must work, and your church here, your churches across Barnet have a role, to create one community that extends to all people and that recognises we are all human beings. And that PREVENT session that I sat in was a disgrace. Now, one hopes that it was not characteristic, but you can understand that people will get alienated if they sense that there are witch hunts going on. And that is why I call for all of our measures to be reviewed from the eyes of a person who is in receipt of those measures. Because I know that if I took any of you here with me and sat in that PREVENT session with me, you would say, not in my name, we've got to do something better than this.
Every act of terrorism is an atrocity, and every act of terrorism is unnecessary and should not occur. It upsets me that tonight we've referred simply to Muslims and ethnic minorities when last June Joe Cox was shot, not for an ethnic minority, but the last person who was born in this country. This is not a problem, but a simple 10-word answer that I can give you tonight. It's a much more complicated issue than can be answered right here, right now. But it's about a safe and stable world that we all live in and a safe and stable community that we all contribute to. Because looking around the world, these things are not just a uniquely British problem. They're happening in schools across America with shootings. They're happening in Paris and in Norway and in Germany. And it's happening because people feel isolated, people feel alienated, people feel left behind. And what we need to do is come together as communities and build strong links. We need to empower our teachers to be able to watch what's happening and stop children and young people falling away from their peers. and so that they feel included. We need to invest in our community services like social workers so that the infrastructure is there to support these individuals. And we need uniformed police on the street, uniformed police like my grandfather, who used to work in the Metropolitan Police, who are there, part of their community, who know their community, who serve their community and want to keep their community safe. But these are all just part of the issue. There's also our international programme that has to be addressed. And it's been said that Jeremy Corbyn is not the person to lead on terror. Well, as he reminded Theresa May and the Conservative Party this week, he didn't walk through that lobby on his own. Often he walked through the lobby when voting against some of this legislation with Conservative MPs, with Conservative cabinet members now. So the question is about who do you trust to tackle terrorism while protecting your civil liberties? And I don't believe that there is anyone better positioned than someone who has constantly stood up to those terrorist legislations that encroach on our civil liberties, but making sure that they keep us safe as well. And it's not safe to cut 19,000 police officers and six armed.
Pleased to hear that brings the questions to an end. Each candidate will now have 2 minutes, and I'm going to be timing very strictly, 2 minutes each, to sum up, and then we'll bring the proceedings to a close. We're going to go in reverse order to the opening speeches. Theresa, would you like to go first, please?
The country faces a simple choice a week from today. Do they want Theresa May as their Prime Minister, or do they want Jeremy Corbyn as their Prime Minister?
Yeah.
I think it's strongly that we need Theresa May leading those Brexit negotiations, which will start just 11 days after polling day. We need her to be in charge of our economy so that we can continue to deliver the economic success story that Conservative government has delivered over the last few years. And we need Theresa May in Downing Street to prevent the arrival of Jeremy Corbyn with a manifesto which would take us back to the 70s in terms of the tax and spend agenda.
Yay.
The reality is they cannot possibly fund the promises they have made. And so therefore there are only the outcome would inevitably be much higher taxes for all of us, more borrowing, and there's nothing moral about increasing the debts for our children and grandchildren. There's nothing moral in wrecking the public finances so that the country goes bust and we can't fund the public services we want. So it is a stark choice. It's back to the 70s with Jeremy Corbyn and a hard left manifesto, or it's stable leadership with Theresa May.
Okay, this is strong and stable.
Well, the Green Party has an uphill struggle to get itself heard. It's much easier if you are UKIP. But in spite of that, we have had to punch against our weight, and hopefully we'll be getting at least one MP into Parliament, which will be able to also be able to keep the toes on other parties to make sure we have a really proper scrutiny of what's going on with Brexit. Hopefully in the future we'll be having a progressive alliance that we learn to do deals with each other. Well, deals, that sounds a rather suspicious word, but at least we will be able to work together to form a real progressive alliance that we can work. The issues that we are in common with, that we share in common, and that we will be able to be more efficient. So hopefully we'll be getting a hung parliament.
Thank
it's been said tonight repeatedly that we have unfunded promises in the Labour manifesto. We fully costed our manifesto. The Tories have had to admit that they cannot tell you how much their preschool breakfast plan will cost. They won't tell you what the social care cap will be. They're asking you for a blank cheque. They're saying, trust us because we know what's best for you. They don't know what's best for you. I don't know what's best for you. The only people who know what's best for you next week is you, because it's your choice when you go to the ballot box. I've been told tonight that Labour aren't ambitious. We are ambitious. Look at our manifesto. We've set forward a vision for this country. And that's the difference. Labour wants to dream big for this country. And when we dream big, we achieve. Everyone said you couldn't build the NHS. We did, it's still here. And we want to make sure it's properly invested in. Everybody said the minimum wage was a pipe dream. It's here, and we want to increase it. And you know what? It's still working. Sure Start worked, but it's been rolled back. It lifted children out of poverty. But the time has come for this country to dream big again. And we do face a very stark choice next week when we all go and vote at the ballot box. Do we want 5 more years of austerity, of the NHS on its knees, of growing class sizes and underinvestment in education, and the prospect of a hard Brexit, or as has been made clear by the Conservatives, no deal at all? Or do we want a government that wants what's best for this country, that will strive for workers' rights, that will think about the many people in this country, not just the few at the top, and offer tax deals and sweetheart deals? No, we have a vision for this country, a vision that we will deliver. We have costed it, we know it's possible, and we will do it. And that is why I'm asking you to believe that I will, one, stand up for you in Parliament, listen to you in this constituency, and fight for you, and be your representative, not my own. And that I will work with my Labour colleagues in Parliament to make sure that this country can achieve the greatness that it is possible for this country to achieve. We've done it before, we can do it again, but we need you to vote for us for that to be possible. And that's why I'm asking you to send me to Parliament on your behalf next week.
This is the election which we were told several times would not be called, but it was nonetheless. Think about the successful tactic when this person goes to negotiate with 27 other countries. The proposed changes, the issue of Brexit is so serious that it was called nonetheless, and you face a very serious decision. You are being asked by some, both in the Labour Party and in the Conservative Party, to sign a blank cheque, a series of blank cheques, on the country's financial future, and that of our jobs, our schools, our hospitals, which the Liberal Democrats will ensure are fully funded, and our old age. You've heard of the dementia tax. You've heard about consultation on the cap. It's wrong that there's been a U-turn. There's been no U-turn. We are still under threat of the dementia tax. They'll consult. They can ignore us. They had a manifesto pledge to put a cap in place by April 2016. Page 39 and page 65 of the Conservative 2015 manifesto. They've broken their promises, and they've done worse. They put in a policy far worse than anything they promised. I believe that the people should choose whether to accept the terms of Brexit or not when the final terms are known. Why should you have a shotgun held to your head for next Thursday? They still haven't given you the details. Let you decide when you have the details. You wouldn't be asked to do this in any financial services industry. It's bad practice. It's malpractice. You make the decision. on the day when you have the full information on what Brexit means. Who knows what Brexit means? The only definition we've heard is that it means Brexit. That's fairly meaningless. We are here having a general election not only because of the serious situation, but also because of an incompetent Labour Party. An incompetent and disunited Labour Party in opposition of the last 2 years, who repeatedly question whether Jeremy Corbyn is the right person to lead the Labour Party. How can that group of people also come and say meaningfully to you that he's now, all of a sudden, the same person, the right person to lead the country? How is that possible? That is a question for you to answer, not for me. It is in your power to end the debacle by choosing to vote for something different, for an experienced party, a party of government, who works for all in this country and for the whole country. We believe in reducing that inequality, which is creating the alienation amongst people of all backgrounds. Every single vote sends a message. The pollsters don't know what is going on. Vote for the policies that you believe in. We have left you copies of our policies on all the seats. So please have a good look at them and vote for what you believe in. We in Barnet need to speak out and strongly oppose any inclinations to reduce UK influence outside the country. Every vote sends a message. The greatest threat to us all, Rachel Douglas, is climate change. And by reducing British influence outside our country, we reduce our ability to tackle it. If you want to be sure that we put our children first and we fund the NHS, and we protect children's future by protecting our planet, and we protect our schools and our early years and childcare, then vote for a Liberal Democrat MP next Thursday. Vote for an open, tolerant and united country. Vote for Marisha Ray. Thank you very much.
Thank you all very much for coming, and thank you for the stewards at the back who've helped with sound and microphones, and thank you very much to everyone involved and to the candidates for coming here this evening. I'm going to close in prayer and with a blessing, so have a few moments of quiet. Go forth into the world in peace, be of good courage, hold fast to that which is good, render to no one evil for evil, strengthen the faint-hearted, support the weak, help the afflicted, honour all people. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit rest upon you and upon this nation, now and always. Amen. Thank you all for coming. It's been good to see you.
Thank you.
Hi, guys. Thank you so much. Keep watching. Hope you enjoyed that. Okay, the two shaking hands. Nice. By the way, as you can see, a lot of really polished speakers. Well, Phil is an amateur, but he's a great guy. And anyway, yeah, that's it. That's all I can say. Please make the right decision. God, I hope you guys don't. Yeah, don't vote for the dementia tax anyway. Or 7p breakfast with children. Peace out. I shall see you later.